Welcome to a 2v2 on Crossing in the Woods. This game is going to be part-time ninja and Spark Trooper, a team I haven't seen in a while. I know that's an arranged team. Versailles Ableman and Please Call Me Dad, which I also know is an arranged team. So I know all four of these players.
Fresh conscripts have arrived.
Look at that.
Well done, comrades.
Good job, me. I'm well integrated into the KOTU community. Battle group headquarters going up here on the left side. It is going to be Crossing in the Woods. Mixed axis going left. MG42 setting up, checking the cutoff right here. Battle group going for forward reinforcement around the left side fuel end. Victory points, so they're going to set up a very strong defense in this area. And then part-time ninja and Spark Trooper playing as double Soviets. They've got a pretty balanced mix of guard, motor, mechanized assault, shock rifle, and then one random commander that I don't think is going to get chosen, but happens to be hanging around in the loadout, saying, oh, I hope I get picked. Hope I get picked this game. Put me in, coach. Combat engineers taking control of the right side, completely uncontested, no Axis forces over here at all thus far. Pyos grab the center VP briefly. There will be some back and forth for the left side fuel, but clearly the Axis have brought more to bear over here, and light probing attempt by the Soviets will get pushed back into the base. There, conscripts actually gets suppressed by a second machine gun? No, it's the same machine gun, rotated a little bit. But a second one is in production here, Please Call Me Dad. First one forces a couple retreats already, I think. Doing a good job of maintaining control of this general crossing. This avenue approach, both important to maintain general knowledge of for the protection of that cutoff right there and make sure the fuel keeps flowing. Over here on the left side, Sturm Pioneers are about to get that captured, and even the munitions and strategic points on the north half of the river getting taken. That flamethrower gets focused down by Grenadiers in the back. I think the engagement could go to the Axis here. Folks Grenadiers trying to absorb some of the damage. MG42, second MG42, manages to get a burst off on those conscripts and suppress them. So that helps. Grenade toss right there, and the conscripts will be forced to retreat. There's the forward retreat point from Cy Ableman. Getting that at 3 minutes leaves him with a very small army, but the MG42s and Grins seem to be providing just enough support to keep their small little bit of territory under control. If they lose this, then they'll probably lose the game. So now that they have their infrastructure set up, they're gonna start growing their army and trying to expand a little bit, start making slightly better harassment attempts for the middle and areas in this area. And I think one of the biggest problems Axis has on this map is getting a munitions point under control, especially if they go hard for one half of the map. It can be really hard to actually get across the river and get that munitions taken, and if you expand too far away from the battle group on the left side, you might struggle to get this munitions taken. If both Axis players go in separate directions, they may find themselves weak against a strong allied early game. So, and that's a similar problem in 1v1s as well. Probably more so in 1v1 than in 2v2. In 2v2, I think Axis have a much better chance of getting early munitions control. But when they are both concentrating very heavily in the same general area, mostly team weapons supporting an over-commando west core of infantry, you can tell that their map control is suffering a little bit as a result. Pio harassment of the right side will go uncontested, though, getting control of the right side fuel, so that helps. MG42 packing up a little bit. Trying to pull back to safety. Grenadiers taking control of the right side munitions, and Pyos grabbing the fuel. Axis map control is growing significantly. A lot of Soviet infantry being forced back into the field. This tier 1 build for Soviets is alright, but in 2v2 I think it struggles a little bit. There's much less wipe potential. It gets focus fire down a lot quicker if your teammate's available support, and you can tell that it wasn't really able to stick around in that engagement. Didn't even really force that many hard retreats, just back to this truck, which is no big deal, and fresh Volks Grenadiers are already available to get that recaptured. Soviets will chase away the Pios from the right side with the flamethrower, get that back under control. Conscripts in the house, force some Grenadiers back. Oster player is gonna regroup back in the base, and then probably move up to assist back in the middle again. Double mortar build, actually, from Please Call Me Dad, which normally, I mean, I don't know if I would recommend that, but against double Soviets on crossing in the woods, you can probably afford to go pretty hard into tier 1 like that. There's no U.S. light vehicle on the way, and it's crossing in the woods, so the game's going to last a long time, and they're going to have plenty of time to fire on infantry formations across the river and hope for lucky wipes. You can generally quite safely invest into indirect fire on this map. I think that's well documented. Ooh, grenade! Nice reaction by Spark Trooper. Gets out just in time. Not sure if the squad will survive, though. Retreating away from a full squad. One man remaining across red cover if a good volley connects as they cross the... Well, he's not chasing, so... Squad will get away. Soviet mortar has been fielded as well. Against double Oster mortar, it probably won't have very long to stay in one position before it gets pressured into retreating. It does get a nice hit off on these Volks Grenadiers, though, which will turn the engagement in Spark Trooper's favor and force that retreat. But yeah, it had to retreat out of counter mortar fire quite quickly. Looks like the engagement's going pretty badly over here for Part-Time Ninja. One squad of conscripts wiped already. These guards not doing much better. Under Sturm Pioneer and LMG Grenadier fire, they're getting focused down quite quickly. And will also get wiped, even by suppressed Volks Grenadiers. What a really nasty engagement right there. M3 pulling back to safety. Volks Grenadiers taking control of the left side fuel, and these infantry or quads grabbing the right side back pretty much uncontested. Mortars are up to, wow, 14 kills already between them, which is quite good. I don't know if I've seen them get any lucky wipes, but demo charge down there on the center VP. Mine's going down in the middle as well. Minesweeper Pios, however, are going to spot the demo, so he should be able to get that swept up. Mortars will continue softening everything up over here on the left side. Volks Grenadiers hit that mine. Not sure those... I think those Pios might automatically shoot that up or shoot it or something. Standing there. Rifle grenade clears a maxim over there on the left side. That'll get forced to retreat. Conscripts inside the building. Volks Grenadiers slowly working on the, okay. Pios take that opportunity to shoot at that demo charge. I've never seen that happen before. We are bleeding, Comrade! And blow it up underneath an M3 that is advancing across the center. T-70 on the field, though. T-70 on the field for Spark Trooper. That should start applying some pressure here in the middle. Tier 4 is up. And that'll actually push the T-70 back a little bit, so that'll provide a nice zone of protection in this area against that light tank. T-70 is going to have to look for opportunities elsewhere. LMG Gren's taking control of the left side munitions, and Volks Grenadiers grabbing the strategic point over here on the left. Mortar will be forced to retreat, and Combat Engineers repairing the T-70. Weren't you guys wondering why the replay was called that demo? I mean, everybody's gonna be like, oh yeah, my demo charge was amazing, but I wasn't expecting that. I thought like a big blob of like Volks Grenadiers was gonna blow up or something. That's why I was keeping my eye on it. I was like, oh, I don't want to stop looking at that demo. Something's gonna happen. I'm glad I had the camera pointed at it for that. That was... I am amused. T-70 takes engine damage right there from a Panzerfaust. But it's inflicting some pretty serious damage regardless. Might go down if this comes off cooldown, though, unless it gets some really lucky shots. Ooh, or it gets sniped. Sniped from across the river by the AT gun right there, and the T-70 will go down. Meanwhile, part-time ninja has not teched. Oh, yes, he has. Tier 4. So, Katyusha, I assume. Katyusha's always good on this map. You can't go wrong. Especially against hard turtle mode, double mortar, team weapon, battlegroup headquarters fest. Katyusha should perform very nicely. So Stern Pioneer's pulling away a little bit. Soviets definitely have an early advantage, but they've decided to throw it away by going industry. By going industry on crossing in the woods of all maps. So industry has been picked by Spark Trooper, and Soviet got one repair station up already. Fuel passive fuel bonus has kicked in, and he's going to start fielding lots of tier 3, I assume. New demo charge right there in the middle. Machine gun fight at range. Lots of green cover available over here from M3 plus demo charge crater. So that Maxim has a bit of staying power and try and keep all of this at bay. There's the Katyusha bombarding the battle group, and it's softening things up. I don't think it got a particularly devastating amount of kills though. Clears a mortar, but that's not very expensive. So, not a great opening barrage, but not terrible either. Did a little bit of damage there. Folks Grenadiers trying to force the Maxim. Wow, that was a terrible grenade. Trying to force the Maxim away. Force it to reposition a little bit, while Stern Pioneers look like they're gonna explode. Ooh, late detonation right there. Only one Stern Pioneer taken out right by that demo charge. That was a bit of a waste. Couple squads advancing up the left side, trying to force retreats and maintain control of this area. Grenadiers not being monitored on the left will get wiped. MG42 setting up over here on the left side. Pio's also retreating. Axis will slow the clock and take control of the left side, but they still don't show much signs of being able to take full control of the game, get the clock ticking against the Soviets, and more importantly, take a munitions point. Cyableman has chosen Spec Ops, please call me Dad. Has access to close air support, joint ops, and fortified armor. Obviously, close air support is excellent. On any map, this map included, any will pick it. So, probably pretty hard tier 2 from him to try and shut down industry with anti-tanks, drapes, teller mines, and AT guns, and so forth. T-34 there will get pushed back a little bit. MG-42 being forced to retreat. Another Katyusha barrage coming in here in the middle. And please call me Dad also with close air support at 8 CPs. Does not have the anti-tank strafe yet, so he doesn't have a way to destroy that without actually diving with a Panzer IV. Which misses its shot against that damaged T-34. AT gun moving up to try and support though. I don't think it has vision, fortunately, but it looks like it could very, very possibly go down right there, if anything spots it. Volks Grenadiers taking control of the middle, and these infantry are gonna... Apparently this got harassed, I don't even know how that happened, but apparently it did. A couple squads will try and get that back under control. Steal attempt right here! Wow, how did those guards manage to sneak in there? Coming in from this angle, I guess, but that attempt goes bad. Fast. Everything converges on that location to make sure that mortar does not fall into enemy hands, and they will maintain control of that. Katusha continues to be a problem, though. 9 kills so far, and there will be plenty of room for that number to grow over the course of this game on that battle group headquarters. He just has to keep clicking this general area. He's pretty much guaranteed to hit something, even without vision. Meanwhile, industry continues doing its work over here on the right side. Two T-34s is out, and it's going to keep coming, I assume. At some point, he'll probably start floating for the KV-2, which is probably pretty good on this map. Probably nice to be able to siege from across the river. I don't know, to be fair, I haven't actually seen KV-2 used on this map in a 2v2 scenario much. It's probably alright, I guess. I don't know. Flamethrower clears a Rakettenwerfer for over there on the right side. That's got to retreat back into the base away from T-34s. What's the downside to industry? No, it's not that the KV-2 sucks. The KV-2's alright. The downside is the manpower penalty. If you look, Part-Time Ninja has 234 coming in. Spark Trooper has 151 coming in. The manpower penalty stacks up a lot over the course of a long game, and it bleeds you so much that you can't really afford to keep up in the infantry game. Or maybe even the tank game, depending. For example, something like that happens. It takes an extremely long time to replace losses. And the fuel advantage may not be enough to compensate for the lack of manpower, especially if you lose some vehicles early on, like he has with the T-70 and T-34, which is going to cause him to fall off the longer the game goes. It significantly weakens your late game, and on a map which tends to run late, like Crossing in the Woods, it makes that commander even worse. But yeah, the KV-2 is actually pretty good. KV-2 is pretty good. We are ready. Enemy infantry has our range. If it weren't for the manpower penalty, this commander would be respectable.
Your predecessor died a hero!
Taking fire! Probably be one of the many Colin tank meta commanders. The manpower penalty is too expensive for it to really be popular, I think. I think people will try it a couple times and then decide they don't like it because of that. Panther and Panzer IV. Ooh, I think that Panzer IV is looking for an opportunity against the Katusha. Going with a really sneaky wide flank. He knows he's been spotted by those guards. The Katusha currently just hiding in the base. I don't think he quite feels comfortable fully committing to that. He's just gonna kind of hover here in the back and try and pick up wipes on retreating squads. Recon passed over the base. He will what is that Katusha doing? That's gonna die maybe. Anti-tank strafe on the T-34. Fortunately, Please Call Me Dad didn't notice that just happened. That wasn't a recon. Yeah, it was. It was a recon pass over the base. I don't know. I guess he's too busy trying to manage the threat of these T-34s, and now he has no choice but to pull back to safety away from that marked vehicle from the mechanized support. Looks like that Panzer IV might go down. T-34 shot bounces, though. Panther moves to try and maybe snipe. Not quite. Takes a shot into the fog, not even close. T-34 will get back to safety. Panzer IV will also narrowly get back to safety thanks to a lucky bounce. So I don't think anything went down during that. No tanks from any player. Katusha doesn't go down. No Axis tanks go down. Just a lot of back and forth and dancing and trying to find opportunities, but nobody was able to seal the deal. Folks, Grenadiers take control of the left side. There's another demo charge in the road right here in the middle. Katusha moves up to bombard the battle group headquarters again. No lucky rockets yet. Eastern Pioneers trying to get clear. Looks like that's not going to do anything other than minor damage to the structure. And that should be easy enough to repair. Being forced to fire at really long range because of the threat of Axis medium tanks. Ooh, that demo had potential. Not quite juicy enough to make him click detonate. There is an OKW minesweeper right here, and Please Call Me Dad has one as well, but it's busy repairing over here on the left side. Kind of interesting to see Spec Ops used for the STGs on this map. On this map, I would just get the LMGs. Almost every engagement is at long range, but they seem to be doing all right. Oh, that crush, though. Wasn't monitoring that engagement, and the STG squad gets wiped, so by doing all right, I mean they're dead, and they did nothing. Recon pass coming over the middle to provide vision of various threats. We'll spot this T-34 with the Panther plus recon pass. No anti-tank strafe, though. He doesn't quite see an opportunity. Dive bomb just got dropped, I think, somewhere. Oh! Oh, that could have been devastating. It actually looks like it was pretty devastating. But nothing got wiped, I don't think. Just massive damage. I'm glad I spotted that just in the nick of time. But recon pass coming over the T-34. No anti-tank strafe, just the dive bomb in the base, which inflicted serious bleed, but no wipes. No wipes, I don't think. Yeah, they're alright at long range, but they're just expensive. I mean, LMGs would probably do better at long range for less munitions, which maybe not better, but comparable. I don't think STGs are really worth it. And that's just my experience. I don't know, your mileage may vary. There's the KV-2 setting up in artillery mode across the river, and an ISU-152 on the field as well. Some big guns coming out for the Soviet players now. Axis are gonna have to try and find ways to deal with that. Close air support certainly has the tools. Panther on the field as well. Might even consider a Jagdpanzer or some kind of long-range anti-tank solution. Command Panther could be good at some point. Doesn't have access to the Yag Tiger, unfortunately. Yag Tiger is always a nice thing to have on Crossing in the Woods as well. Lots of Axis forces being bled hard. Dive bomb on the KV-2 right there brings it to about half and clears out a mortar next to it. Not enough to destroy it completely. T-34 engaging on the right side, takes some Panzerschreck and Panther fire. That's gonna have to pull back to safety. That's a Vet 3 T-34 now. KV-2 falling low to something. Oh, AT gunfire from way in the back. So that's gonna have to pull back for repairs as well. Obviously the industry player has plenty of access to repairs on his repair stations over here. But the Panzer IV is gonna take this opportunity to go in on the ISU-152. Well, it doesn't have very much flank protection. It does take engine damage right there. AT gunfire from across the river on the rear armor. Panzer IV should be able to finish it off. There it goes. Second AT gun actually moving up from both directions like that. Both sides of that forest. Nicely played by Please Call Me Dad, moving up with the AT guns in conjunction with the Panzer IV to damage its engine. Meanwhile, the KV-2 receives repairs here in the back, and the Panther is looking for opportunities against it, but it keeps taking engine damage. Every time I look at that Panther, it has engine damage because it hit a mine or took an AT grenade or something. That Panther's probably had engine damage for more of this game than it's been fully repaired. Fortunately, the AT gun right there was already low and gets cleared by the top mount machine gun. KV-2 is taking shots from across the building, and it is already fully repaired. Meanwhile, this Panzer IV is stuck, I think. It's stuck inside the wreck. I've seen this book before, and it's highly annoying. Panzer IV may die because of that. By the way, if your tank gets stuck inside of a wreck, the fastest way to get free is to destroy the wreck by attacking it manually. Dive bomb coming in. Ooh, that was a pretty good one. Wipes the machine gun, the rest forced to retreat. And that's going to be part-time ninja reduced to only 3 squads remaining, and Spark Trooper has 4 squads remaining, so the Axis have pulled well into the lead and may find an opportunity now to get some map control back. As long as the threat of that KV-2 can be managed, the only high-priority Soviet vehicle target less left on the battlefield. No T-34s remain. ISU has already been destroyed. AT gun gets cleared again. A rifle grenade, Rakenwerfer and Panther fire, plus anti-tank strafe coming in from the north. it gets shredded. Panther plus anti-tank strafe. Far too much to deal with. Everything has been destroyed by the Axis here, and they will continue their advance across the right side. Panther supported by Command Panther now. All targets over here look like they will get picked up, including that AT gun for starters. Grenadiers taking control of all of this territory. Spark Trooper with only 2 squads remaining, and Part-Time Ninja with only 4 squads remaining. Looks like that's probably going to be the game. Couple team weapons getting salvaged over here. Salvage the ISU as well. T-34s are going to maybe pick up that Grenadier squad right there. I think he was floating a little bit of fuel, thinking maybe wanted KV-2, but decided to spend it all on T-34s instead, getting those. But the Command Panther plus Panther are clearly having no issue at all with T-34-76s. And that might even go down already. One of them destroyed, the other one gets away with only a tiny amount of HP remaining. Recon pass coming in over the Soviet base, plus stupid dive bomb somewhere. I guess on this flamethrower squad. Alright. Flamethrower squad. There's not really that much left for stupid dive bombs to target, so why not? Timed nicely with that retreat, by the way. Hi, Sherlock.
The enemy is taking our territory.
A couple more squads being rounded up, sent back into the base. And I don't think this game came down entirely to build decisions or commander selection, because no game ever does. I think we saw some pretty good engagements between Soviet heavies and close air support. Certainly pulled more than its fair share of weight this game. I think the Katyusha probably, I don't even know how the Katyusha died. I totally missed that happening, but it is dead now. I guess close air support probably strafed it to death, I assume. So quite a bit of work done by close air support, but not hard tier 2. Please Call Me Dad did go to tier 3 and get a Panzer 4 out to help him out, and he did a lot of good work with that. Certainly helped him deal with the threat of the ISU-152 quite nicely. Got that up to Vet 2 by the end of the game. And it's always fun to actually see Spec Ops. That's one of my favorite commanders to cast. I like the Command Panther. I don't know. Although, yeah, I don't really think he got very good usage out of STGs this game. He's only got 1 squad left by the end. They've got 6 kills, no vet. I don't know if he got a lot of mileage out of those. I think LMGs are just a little bit easier to use safely on this map, especially in a 2v2 situation. In 1v1, maybe not so much, but GG. Axis wins.